doing this to kind of develop a little springboard for you to really begin to get where we can really begin to make progress in terms of reaching people. On Sunday, it was really amazing. There was quite a few people here that really needed the Lord. And we don't have a lot of opportunities to use our anointing and our knowledge to reach people. Okay, Psalms 112, verse 1 and 2. It says, praise ye the Lord. Blessed is the man that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. I'm going to read the rest of it. His seed shall be mighty, most mighty upon earth. The generation of the upright shall be blessed. Wealth and riches shall be in his house, and his righteousness endureth forever. Until the upright there arises light in the darkness, and gracious and full of compassion and righteousness. A good man showeth favor and lament, he will guide his affairs with discretion. Surely he shall not be moved forever. He shall not be afraid of evil tidings. His heart is fixed, trusting in the Lord. So we can see that praising the Lord and blessing the Lord and delighting greatly in his commandments, amen, it can work wonders in various areas of your life. I mean, it just about covers every area of need that you will have. So that's the area that we want to really begin to focus on, because the person that bless the Lord and that feareth the Lord, that delighteth greatly in his commandments. We have so many benefits and promises and provisions that we can see in that particular. Now, the scripture teaches us that we are kings and priests unto God, and our primary responsibility, everybody said primary responsibility. The main reason why God created us, man, is for his glory, to magnify him and to praise him and to exalt him and to cause a revelation of God to be revealed or made known to men. And much of it is going to be focused on our praise. Amen. On praise and magnifying God. And so we are to offer continuously spiritual sacrifices. Everybody said that we are priests, and our job primarily is to offer up what? Spiritual sacrifices. Y'all know what spiritual sacrifices are? All right, the spiritual sacrifices we need to offer up is the sacrifice of what? Praise. Amen. That is to be continually. Now, if we can find a people that will do that, you will find a people that will be anointed, that will be free from whatever captivity, whatever yokes or burdens or whatever the devil will try to bring. So I'm trying to get us to approach the Word of God with a real appreciation for the things that God has provided to us, especially the things that God has provided through his redemptive work. Amen. And that's the thing that make every redemptive reality real to you. Every redemptive work that God has performed for you, that's the way that we make it reality, by cultivating a rich spirit of praise and thanksgiving. So that's the way that we need to approach. We don't want to continue to look downcast and sad and discouraged and frustrated and not display. Bible says we are the chosen generation, royal priests of the holy people, and we are called to show forth the glory of him that have called us out of what? Darkness into this what? Marvelous light. So it's got to be on your face now. It's got to be in your heart. It's got to be written all over your countenance that you are a person that that really experiencing the joy of the Lord, and your main purpose is to glorify and to magnify him. Amen. So when we read the Word of God, find something in that Word that will cause you to what? Rejoice and really give God thanks. Amen. So I just wanted to bring that to your attention. The scripture that I mentioned today, it was in all of these provisions and blessings, you know, sometimes we don't get excited about them. We just take it for granted. And therefore, if we take them for granted, it will not work for us. It will not do anything for us. So it's good to even begin to learn to sing and make melody about, you know, the Bible says, do it in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. All right, Luke 12:32. What did I say? Luke 12:32. Yeah. Everybody read together. What does it say? Okay. Fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Okay, so one scripture says that fear not, O ye lands, rejoice and be glad, and the Lord will do great things. So if it's God's good pleasure to give us the kingdom, and we know the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, according to Romans 14:17. It's not meat and drink, but it's righteousness. And righteousness is a big thing. Righteousness is a real big issue. Righteousness is a right standing with God, and that speaks about God restoring back to you the place that you had as a created being from the beginning. The very status or position or place that you held in God. Amen. The Bible says that we were made in the image of God, and we were made for His glory. We were made to reflect His nature, His and all of His divine attributes. And righteousness means that you have been restored back to that place of dignity, that place of glory, that place of power. And it speaks about being a ruler, having dominion, and having control over everything. It's a just exalted position. Everybody just say exalted position. That's what righteousness is. It's being in a position of authority, a position of power, and a position where you exercise dominion, and nothing is supposed to dominate us. So whenever we get under the dominion of sin, Satan, or sickness, or anything, you know that that's not the position that God has called you to be. You work your way out of it. Amen. And the Bible says that one way that we can work our way out of it and experience those blessings, amen, is through delighting greatly in God's word. Delighting greatly. Amen. Lord, you exalt God. There's a scripture that I mentioned today. I will praise the name of the Lord with a song. I praise Him with a song, but I will magnify Him with thanksgiving. Amen. That's the way you magnify God. And when you magnify Him, He gets bigger than what? Your problems. Bigger than your challenges. Bigger than your conflicts. Bigger than whatever you're going through. So that's the way out. That's the way you dig your way out of the hole or whatever oppression or whatever you're going through. Amen. The Bible said the man that delighted greatly, that feared the Lord and delighted greatly. Amen. I put some emphasis on that word greatly. Amen. Praise God. He's going to be what? He's going to be what? Blessed. Greatly in His what? Commandments. Wealth and riches shall be. Now, somebody needs to be delighted a little stronger if wealth and riches is going to be in your house. If the seed of the upright is going to be blessed, and all of those blessings and benefits in Psalm 112 is going to become reality to you. Amen. I'm learning how to perfect that. Amen. Amen. Blessed is the man that fears the Lord and that delighteth what? Greatly. How many can say, y'all look happy now. Delighteth what? Greatly. Joy is the key, right? Joy, 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 joy. Amen. So the reason why we focus on that, because to me that's the highest expression of faith. When you begin to rejoice and praise God for things before you receive them, that's the highest. Amen. That's the highest form of believing God, of faith. Amen. Praise God. All right. So for instance, sister, thank you for making me some biscuits. if I keep on focusing on my things, amen. can't get excited about it. Honey, I can't wait until you. Sooner or later, she's going to be what? Motivated.
Get a can of Pillsbury.
She's saying that, but. She's saying that, but. Praise works wonders. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. So I had some scriptures that I had read because I want to cultivate this hope until I can actually see God's, I want to see God's healing power working mightily. And I believe that it's all in overcoming and overruling all of the stuff that the devil has programmed in our minds as to what God will do through us or what God won't do. We got to overrule all of the negative, all of the doubt and unbelief. And I believe that the best way to get it out and to eradicate it and the best way to overcome the flesh, amen, the flesh will always what oppose you at every what turn. How many can say amen? But the Bible says we the circumcision, ooh, glory. We worship God in the spirit. Amen. Praise God. And we what? Rejoice in who? Y'all don't know that yet? We rejoice in who? Jesus Christ. And we have what? No confidence in the flesh. Amen. We can get beyond our flesh and really praise the Lord and actually function in the role that we've been primarily called to do, offer spiritual sacrifices. If you want God to do something, amen, he requires a what? Sacrifice. Amen. Sacrifice of what? Thanksgiving. That's the way you magnify him. Magnify him, and you praise him in a song, but you magnify him with what? Thanksgiving. The Bible says this shall please the Lord more than any what? Ox, bullock that you can offer up that has horns and hoofs. The humble shall what? See it, hear it, and be what?
Glad.
The humble shall hear. When you begin to rejoice, it not only affects you. It not only places you in a position where the realities that God has promised us from this redemptive work become real, but it will always affect people. It will always what? Affect people. I remember the first night I came back after being gone about 5 weeks. Amen. And I felt like I feel it all the time, but I have had a little restraint, you know. Some said, "Well, you shouldn't go. You shouldn't, you know, you shouldn't, you know, exert yourself or move too soon." But I felt like if I could just come and be in the midst of the saints praising the Lord, I felt like it would turn some things around in my body. Amen. The first time I came, amen, I acted a fool and prayed. Y'all remember that first night I came? Is that right? It was on a Wednesday night. I mean, I came on a Sunday initially first, but when I came back for prayer, Bible study, I think it was on a Wednesday night. Is that right? Amen. And when I came and just praised the Lord for about 15 or 20 minutes, y'all remember that session? Amen. I was trying to pull it out of y'all because I needed it, and y'all didn't think I needed it. So I had to press y'all to make you what? Amen. To push you. But there's nothing that can equate to establishing an atmosphere where God is glorified and magnified and there's a spirit of rejoicing. I mean, it has a healing impact, big time. And that night, amen, that was the night I first realized, because being alone, y'all don't realize this, being alone for a long period of time and not being with the saints overall, because my wife and I, we did a whole lot of things together, but she was under a lot of pressure and burden, and every turn was hers, and every meal she had to cook, and every place we go she had to drive, and every grocery list she had to go in and pick up. Amen. So she didn't have a whole lot of energy after about a month or so. That just wore out. And she just said, "Well, I'm tired," and you know. Amen. She didn't complain, but I could tell that she was getting tired. So I said, "I need some strength from somewhere." And when I came and began to praise the Lord, amen, something was released that I just didn't experience on my own. So I know there's a blessing, amen, in coming together and worshiping the Lord and drawing from the saints. The Bible says that the humble shall hear thereof, and they shall be what? I believe that's in the scripture. I want to make sure that that's in the scripture. I believe it's... circumstances and the things you're going through can look much bigger than God. How many can attest to that? I'm not sure whether this is what you want or not, but I'm just saying it because I'm on the scripture. Many times when you are going through things and you suffer adversity, many times you have conflict, and many times you will have challenges. That's the time that you really have to persevere and be determined that you're going to offer sacrifice like God demands. That's the time that you have to determine whether you obey God or you will just operate in your flesh. And that's a decision that you have to make, because we are constantly confronted with different trials, and the trial of our faith is an experience, a common experience that we have on a consistent basis. Okay, so if you don't have joy, if you seems like you don't get where you need to get in order to experience victory, that many times will go back to the fact that you might have seen your circumstance bigger than God. You know, sometimes our circumstances, the things that we can be magnified above God, because your mind is beyond that, and you can't release, you can't get into the Word. The Word was not permitted to have its free course. And you just have to make up your mind that you're going to magnify God until God gets bigger than your problem. How many believe you can do that? You can magnify God until he gets bigger than the problem. In fact, that's the way you rid yourself of a whole lot of what? Doubt and unbelief and a whole lot of barriers that hinder you from receiving what you want from God. Now, how many know that you can have faith in your heart? Because if we are consistently under the Word, we got faith in our hearts, but many times there's doubt in our minds, sometimes especially when we are involved in some type of challenge. We have doubt in our minds. How many of you can have doubt in your mind, and you can have what? Faith in your heart. Y'all don't believe that's possible?
Yes.
Amen. All of us, amen, got faith in our hearts. Is that right? But many times we have what? Doubt. Our minds get what? Cloudy. Is that right? And sometimes the devil will talk to your mind and convince you that it's not what? This is not possible. You will never get through this. This is going to happen. How many of you heard from the devil? And the devil really took you down this road and showed you all of the things that's waiting to happen, and that he had, that you cannot what, get victory over. But the way to eradicate that, this has always been the way that people have gotten victory and experienced the miraculous, is that you've got to, if you can't do it on your own, you have to what? Get with other people and bring the level of your what? Praise and worship up to a certain point. If you can get to a certain point, amen, praise and worship, if you look through the Bible, I mean, look at all the victories they won through praise and worship. Just name some of them.
Jehoshaphat.
Jehoshaphat, that was a clear case. I mean, that was a huge case. The walls of Jericho, you know what, they fell flat, right? And most of the promises and provisions you will find in the Word of God are possible through worship, because that's the thing that will eradicate, that will eliminate, and that will undo much of what the devil has established in your mind. Scripture does say the weapons of our warfare are not what? Carnal, but they are what? Mighty through what? God. Is that right? We can't, amen, lean to the arms of the flesh. The Bible says, worship the Lord in the Spirit, right? Rejoice in Jesus Christ, and what? Have no confidence in the flesh. And the Bible said the Lord will do great what? Things. Delight yourself in the law of the Lord, he will give you what? The desires of your heart. So I just want to kind of steer you in that particular area. This scripture says, I will praise the name of God with a song and will magnify him with what? Thanksgiving. This also shall please the Lord better than an ox or bullock that have horns and hoofs. The humble shall see this and be glad. Today when I first came into the church, I was about 5 minutes late. But Sister Wayne was running all over this place. She was running all around Hawaii. Can you believe that? And, man, and as soon as I hit the door, man, I heard those praises, man, I just got glad. He just set the tone for me to do whatever the Lord would lead me to do. So that's the thing that we're going to focus on, because the humble should see this. That's the reason why people used to like to come to the sanctified church. Is that right? It was because of their what? Rejoicing. Y'all know that's the truth. The saints used to what? Man, they could dance all over the place.
Sing and shout.
Sing and shout. And they liked the music. They liked to see the saints what? Dance. It made them what? Feel good. And many times while the saints were praising God, the Holy Ghost would what? Fall on some of them. They would fall out and start what? Amen. Praise God. Start quickening and praising God and rolling on the floor. And so it's a real blessing in magnifying God, because when we magnify him with thanksgiving, things begin to happen, because the humble shall see it, be glad, and your heart shall live that what? Seek God. Amen. If you want more life, ooh, glory. Amen. How many want more life?
Amen.
Amen. More life is the answer for every need and problem that we have. More life. More life. More life. More life. And you can get that life, hallelujah, and you can create that in an atmosphere where you have people really rejoicing. So, Neil, you might want to give an example. Okay, but what I was saying, the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness. And I was mentioning that righteousness is being restored back to that original position that God created man initially. Because the scripture says he was created, crowned with what? Glory and honor. And he was made to have dominion. And God placed everything under his feet. And that's the position, the exalted position. Amen. How many can say the exalted position? We're not just little peons. Amen. We are rulers. God made us to rule and not to be ruled. Okay, so we were made rulers, and we were given what? Authority and power over all of the works of God's hands. And Jesus made sure that was restored through all of the suffering and the things that he went through in order to restore us back and to reconcile us back to God. Okay, now all things that we started out, we had dominion over all things. All things were ours and under our feet. So all things, everybody just say all things.
All things.
All right, all things are yours. That means that if we do what God says do and exalt him and bless him and exalt, amen, and praise him. God will give us revelation. We will have the knowledge and the ability, amen, and praise him, and the wisdom to receive all of these things that God has provided. All things. Now, y'all remember the scripture that we always quote? Let's see. This was Romans 8:32. Just turn there. To show you that all things are yours. So that means that it's not very difficult for us to receive the things that God has already provided. Amen. It's not that difficult. I think that it's not always a mindset. It is receiving the word, but it's more in magnifying God and praising God and placing ourselves in a position where our faith will work and our doubts and unbelief can be eliminated. And that's the position of worship and praise that God has called us to, amen, be. The Bible says we are kings and priests unto who? God. Kings and priests. So Romans 8:32. I just like to talk myself into victory, amen, and praise and praise will become easy. Romans 8. Somebody read that for me.
Mm-hmm. He had spared not his own son, mm-hmm. but delivered him up for us all. Mm-hmm. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things?
Okay, all things means what? Everything that pertains unto life and unto godliness. Everything that we will ever need to get over in this life, that we will ever need, that relate to godliness or that relate to what? Life. Those things have already been what? Freely provided. Through Christ. Amen. So God is not interested in what withholding from you. He's trying to what? Get everything that he made possible and available to you. He's trying to get that what to you. And all of it, that it was all made available through Jesus. Now, 2 Corinthians 8:9 shows that, I'm just going through these things because righteousness means that our dominion has been restored. We are rulers. We're not to be ruled. We're not to be under this. We're not to be under that. And there's a way God has designed for us to get out from under it. Amen. We are under it. We know how to get out from it. And we can know how to teach other people how to get out from it too. Okay, 2 Corinthians, I believe it's 8:9. I'm just going to give you the scripture for this. It says that, for ye know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that ye through his poverty might be what? Rich. Well, how about that? Those scriptures go together. Romans 8:32, God didn't withhold his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him? Woo! Freely! That's the reason why the Bible says, fear not, little flock. Amen. How many part of that little flock today? Fear not. Amen. Tell somebody, fear not, little flock. Fear not. For it's the Father's what? Good pleasure to what? Give you what? The kingdom. The kingdom is not what? Need it, drink. Woo, glory. It's more than what? Some tea. But it's what? Righteousness. And righteousness is a what? Huge issue. It's huge. If your righteousness and your standing with God has been restored, and it's restored when you receive what? Jesus as Lord. But the devil, amen, amen, has what? Has bewitched us because he makes us feel that what? Ain't too much has what? Taken place. We are not about nothing. You still got to be under this. You still got to be what? Subject to this. But righteousness means what? Your position that you started out with, you know, that God knit in his image and in his life. Yes, the Bible says it. Amen. It was predestined that we would be what? Conformed to his image. I mean, God made up his mind a long time ago. How in the world can you carry out the will of God and be, amen, praise God, and reveal God's Son and be that instrument, amen, that God wants us to be and really carry out the will of God if we are not conformed to his image? We got to be conformed to his image. We got to be just like him. And that's what he has done in what? Restoring us back to favor. everything that's needed in order for us to be what? 100%. Amen. God has what? Restored it. Amen. He has what? Restored it back. And the devil has kept us from what? Believing. And our minds get so clogged and not say, well, I can do this. I can have this. This is man. But I don't believe I'm up to this. Amen. So the Bible says, freely give us what? All things. Amen. It's the Father's good pleasure to give us what? The kingdom. And the kingdom of God is what? Amen. Everything that you started out with being what? Restored back to you fully and completely. Everybody just say amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's your position that brings, amen, the priesthood back into play and bring the heirship. The heirship means what? All things are yours again. Praise God, like, amen, praise God mightily, delight greatly, rejoice evermore, woo, in everything, what, give thanks, in everything.
Yes, amen.
Amen. The Bible says when people talk about you, Matthew 5, this is something I read you might need, amen. I'm picking on Sister Irene tonight, Matthew 5. Amen. I know I can use it sometime. Everybody here going to be able to use it. It says Matthew 5, and it says, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely. For my sake, rejoice and be, amen, exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets who were before you. Amen. So many times we're going to be what? Somebody's going to what, cross our path and get us upset and get us very disturbed and frustrated. But the Bible says then we what? Render evil for evil or retaliate, amen, or get back at them, amen, or tell them off or give them the peace of your mind. Bible says what? Rejoice. Amen. Everybody say rejoice. And be what? A little glad. Be what? Amen. I mean extremely glad. I mean, I know you have to push yourself to get to the extreme, the point, right? Amen. But that's what the Word says. So you can see that if we did what the Word says, I think that we would fare a lot better. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay. Those are some of the scriptures. Now, Colossians 1:12. I want to, we got Luke 12. We got Luke 12:32. We got Romans 14:17. 14 says the kingdom of God is not made in dread, but righteousness, peace, joy in the what? Holy Ghost. Joy. Y'all get that? Joy, joy, joy. If you took away the joy of the saint, you'd have much better. You might have a word, but it'd be just a dead word. You're right? Amen. The joy of the Lord. Everybody just say this with me. The joy of the Lord.
The joy of the Lord.
Is my strength.
Is my strength.
Amen. With joy, we draw water out of the what? Wells of salvation. In other words, all of those blessings and provisions God has laid up for us, which eye hasn't seen, God reveals them by His Spirit, and He enables us to what? Draw from that reservoir of blessings through what? Our faith. And our faith can be more or less, we can condense that just said, praising God, amen, for whatever God has what? Promised or provided through His redemptive work. Okay. Colossians 1, it says this. Colossians 1. Amen. I'm so convinced, I'm so challenged because this is the way that
God just quickened to me when I was going through my challenge. Amen. Now, this would work for every trial, every situation, every condition that one will confront. God has devised a way that we can always get out through faith. And faith means what? Fearing the Lord and delighting greatly in His what? Word. When we honor that word, when we push that word up and really begin to magnify the Lord Amen. For what he has said, his provisions, that's the reason why a knowledge of his provisions are so important. Okay, let me give you Colossians 1. It says, Colossians 1, and for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Okay, but that is so important. You desire to be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. But let me just back up. Now, righteousness is not going to be a reality until we begin to walk pleasing to God. In other words, walk righteousness and holiness. Holiness is very important because I just mentioned all of the benefits that one gets from being restored back to favor. In other words, your position restored. Your rulership, your heirship, your priesthood, and all of these exalted positions that God restores when we get saved. But once we get saved and born again, then the next issue is controlling your body, sanctification. Because if you don't walk in holiness, then many of these realities that God has provided, amen, are not going to be reality. You got to live the life. How many can say amen? You got to walk. The scripture says, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are what? In Christ Jesus, who walk not after the what? Flesh. But after what? The Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus makes us free. Now all of that is true and reality if we do not walk according to the what? Flesh. That's the reason why the scripture says, we worship the Lord in the Spirit. This is your vocation. Worship the Lord in the Spirit. That means, you know, just give it all you have. And rejoice in Jesus Christ and have no confidence in your flesh. Okay, the 10th verse, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might, according to his glorious power, unto all patience and longsuffering with joyfulness. Now, verse 12, giving thanks, even that word giving thanks, unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light. Okay, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be, that means, meet means to be capable or able to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints. And like, you know, in other words, all of the things God has provided through his redemptive word, amen, God wants you to give him thanks for causing you to be positioned in a way where all of these realities that he has provided can become yours. Amen. You know, that is something that God wants thanks just for making it possible for you to be capable of what? Enjoying your part or your share of what? Your inheritance. Amen. How many people will ever have a revelation of that and be thankful for all of, for God making you an able minister or able or capable of what? Tapping into all of the blessings and provisions that he has provided. All right, who hath delivered us? I like that. Who hath delivered us? Amen. Anybody see anything in any of those verses that you could really get excited about? Who hath delivered us from the power of what? Darkness, and hath what? Translated us into the kingdom of his what? Dear Son, in whom we have what? Redemption through his blood, even the what? Forgiveness of sins, who is the image of the visible God, the firstborn of every creature. Anybody see anything in those verses that could get you excited about what God has done for you redemptively? And if I see anything in those verses,
when
Because, see, we are talking about cultivating a genuine spirit of what? Rejoicing. And when you can't see, amen, when you can see things in scriptures that really turns you on, amen, you can always resort back to those. The scriptures like this, I usually keep them at my disposal. I just like to look at them and say them and just praise God for them on a continuous basis. Amen. How many believe that God making it possible for you to be able to enjoy the provisions and blessings that He has what made accessible to you? Is that a big issue? And it's really quiet. He says, giving thanks. So sometimes we just overlook things, but He says what? Giving thanks. Amen. Who had delivered us? Are we to give thanks for being delivered? Being translated into the kingdom of His dear Son? For being reconciled back to God? Being restored back to, amen, right standing with God? Amen. Especially after we were once alienated and enemies in our minds by wicked works. Bible says He has reconciled us through the body of His flesh to present us unblameable. Oh, Lord. Amen. How many feel unblameable tonight? How many can say, amen, there's therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus? Amen. How many feel free of sin? Sin shall not have what? Dominion. It's good to be, amen, free from the burden of sin. Amen. Is that right? The wages of sin is what? Death. Amen. And also the scripture says that the way of a transgressor is what? Heart. Amen. We have redemption through His blood. Amen. He bought us back, purchased us with the price of His blood. How many know that was a high price, high cost? And scripture says, amen, we're bought with a price. Everybody said we've been bought with a price. Amen. Say it out loud. We are bought with a price. And can anybody else finish it out? And we are to what? Glorify God in our bodies. Okay, now turn to that 1 Corinthians. I just want you to have a knowledge of it. 1 Corinthians 6:30, I believe. It might be 2 Corinthians. No, it's 1 Corinthians 6:20. Let's look at 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. So our bodies become the temple of the Holy Ghost. For ye are bought with a price, therefore, what? Glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are what? Okay, so it goes right back to show you that we are called on an ongoing basis to offer up what? Spiritual sacrifices to God for all of the blessings and all of these provisions He has what? Made possible and accessible to us. All right, how many believe that we do an adequate job of carrying out our role as priest? I'm a king. I'm a ruler. Amen. I was made to rule and not to be ruled. So you are king. Tell somebody you're a king, whether you know it or not, or believe it or not, you are a king. You exert dominion. Sometimes we're scared to say things like that, but the Bible says you're kings and priests. That's what kings do. They do what? They exercise what? Dominion, authority, power. Amen. Oh, glory. Say, I'm a king.
I am a king.
Say, as He is, so am I. Say, I'm seated with Him in heavenly places. I don't mean that you're up there in heaven, but I mean your position has what? Changed from a position of what? Subservient to what? Sin and the power of darkness. And you've been elevated and promoted back to your what? Original place that God what? Made you. That image has been what? Restored. Ooh, glory. How many can say that? By image. Amen. So I'm seated with Christ. That means that you and Christ are what? One as he is, so are you. So you are Jesus. The Bible says he that sanctified and those that are sanctified are all of one. Amen. He said, I'm not ashamed to call you my what? Brother. Amen. He's not ashamed to call us brethren. So we are brothers, we're heirs of God, and we are what? Joint heirs with who? Jesus. I don't know whether that means anything to anybody, but the scripture says we're to glorify God in your body and in your spirit because you have been what? Restored back, and you've been made acceptable, amen, in God's presence again. Glorify God in your what? Body. Okay, let me see how y'all glorify God. Laugh, be happy. How do you glorify God in your body? Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right. I like that scripture in Colossians. I'm just about done, Colossians. I'm just kind of... Colossians 1, we did that one, right? Colossians 1, okay, we did that one. Colossians 3, I really like this one. It says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts to the which, this is 3:15, and let the peace of God. All right, so righteousness, peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. This talks about the peace of God, let it rule. Amen. So if you got that joy, that peace will rule in your hearts. To the which also ye are called in one body, and be ye sad. Be ye what? Amen. That word thankful comes in so many places. That shows that all of the provisions and blessings that God has provided requires us to be what? Thankful. Because that's the way we demonstrate and release our faith in God's word. Okay, let the word of God, let's read it together. Let the word of God dwell in you what? Richly in all what? Wisdom, teaching, and admonishing one another. In what? Psalms and hymns. And what? Spiritual songs. What? Singing. All right. Singing with what? Sadness in your heart. Grace in your heart to the Lord. All right. So all of this is focusing on the attitude and the disposition that we need to what? Acquire and cultivate in order to make God's best reality in your life. Okay, 17. Let's read together. And whatsoever ye what? Do in what? Whatsoever. That means everything you do in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Giving what? Thanks again. Giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. You know, it's so much emphasis on what? Thanksgiving. And I haven't even began to cover all of the passages that focus on the importance of giving thanks. But we can just sum it up in this way. It says, in everything, give what? Thanks. Amen. In everything. Now, the passages that you really want to focus on, I'm just going to just give them to you. I can't read them. Colossians 1, verse 20, verse 19 through 23. Okay. Those are the verses that deal with your restoration, your redemption. And it puts it all in a nutshell. And I look at that all the time. Colossians 1:19 through, because that shows the position you were in before Jesus became sin for you, so that you might be made the righteousness of God. And it shows the original place you were in, condition, the original condition, and the position that God has restored you back to. And that is really important. Colossians 1, that I read earlier, 12 through 14, that also is a passage that deals strictly with your being restored back to faith, or back to your original place. And you are to give them thanks. Now let me just give you one or two more scriptures. In 1 Peter, so if you can work with your joy, your rejoicing, and then begin to read your Bible, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and just look for every opportunity to rejoice. You can stop whenever you want to and start praising God for something that God has done for you. Okay, 1 Peter. First Peter, two. Okay, it says here, to whom cometh, this is verse 4:24. Let's start with the first verse. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all what? Guile, and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings. And as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow. So we are trying to get back into the Word. So, amen. I believe that there's going to be a real desire as you begin to praise the Lord for more and more of the Word. If so be ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom as unto a living stone disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also as lavish stone, are built up a spiritual house. Okay, what kind of stones are we? What kind of stones are we? What kind of stones, amen, stones are we? All right, now lavish stones means that, you know, you just have to cultivate that spirit of praise until, amen, that becomes reality. Are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood. So I told you we've been priests. To offer up what? Spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Okay, wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you therefore which believe, he is precious. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is what? Precious. But unto them that be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of a corner. And a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient. Wherefore also they were appointed. All right, everybody together on verse 9. But ye are a what? Chosen generation, a what? Royal priesthood and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. So that scripture shows that we were formed or created to praise the Lord. That's our primary responsibility of what? Magnifying the Lord. Whatever we do in word or in deed, Bible says do it all in the name of our Lord, Savior Jesus Christ. Hebrews 13:15, that's the last one. And that would be scriptures which are designed to make you mindful of the need to rejoice and to delight greatly in his word or in his commandments. All right, 13, 15, everybody together. It says this, by him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of what? Praise to God. What? Continually. Praise to the sacrifice of praise to God. How? Say it again. That is the what? Fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name. All right, so all things by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving. That's Philippians 4:6. Amen. Be careful for nothing. Don't let nothing scare you. Be afraid of nothing, but in all things by what? Prayer and what? Supplication. Let your request, amen, with thanksgiving, let your request be made what? No. So what did y'all get out of all of these scriptures tonight? And just did this because I think that these are scriptures that I gave out today and scriptures that we want you to be ever mindful of when you begin to start reading the Bible. You look for things in the Bible that really turns you on. And you just praise God and magnify him for those provisions and blessings that he has what? Amen. Made possible, because they're going to be quickened. All right. Now I want to just get a response. What did you get? Did you get anything out of any of those verses in terms of things that could really enrich your walk with the Lord tonight? I just want to see three hands. Hey, what did you get? Okay, brother, hold on.
Summed up as far as my thankfulness, my role as a Christian in this world, and how I'm supposed to stand in God's view. So, I mean, that turned me up.
That's good.
I'm thankful for that. Also, we always give thanks as well.
Right. All right. All right, brother. Tidwell, you might as well.
Well, I like the scripture that you didn't quantify. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
All right.
Matter of fact, recently, my wife had been discussing that.
Mm-hmm.
The key to our life is the joy.
Ooh.
That's what turns on the power. That's what keeps me from being ill and down in my body and having the affairs of the world on my mind. If I'm locked into that joy, there's no room for all that other stuff.
Boy, Lord.
The other thing I think about, Abraham, every time God did something good for him, what did Abraham do?
Say, worship the Lord.
Well, he built an altar.
That's right.
He built an altar so he could remember every time he passed by that. Well, you know, that's what I do in my mind. Every time God does something for me, I build an altar. In here, I build an altar. Even a little thing. You know, I went to the tag agent one time, and I wasn't thinking. I didn't have my checkbook on me, and I wanted to pay with my Visa card, and they wouldn't take my Visa card. Well, I waited a week or so later, and time was getting up, and I needed to pay my car tag, and ran in there, and in that time period from the time I first came in here to the second time, because my conditions hadn't changed, I still wasn't thinking. Came in there without the checkbook, tried to pay the credit card. Oh yeah, we accept that now. Even a little thing God does for me.
Giving thanks for that is when you were in the hospital, I left one night kind of late, and it was like, oh Lord, that parking lot is way out there, and I'm walking out here alone. And the hospital was so large, I didn't really know my way out until until later I found the shortcut. But this night I walked in the hall and I was just totally lost. And all of a sudden there was a guy with a child on his back. And I said, oh, your child been sick? And he says, no, I'm here visiting my wife. Mm-hmm. I said, okay. And I guess I looked lost. And he said, ma'am, you're trying to find your way out. I said, I sure am. And he said, just follow me. And there was no fear that he was going to lead me in the wrong direction. And I said, okay. And he just led me to an area, to the emergency area, which I was very familiar with. And I told him, thank you. But then when I got there and I said, okay, somebody pulled up in a truck and picked him up. And I thought, okay, my car way over there. And I'm going to have to walk out of here by myself, alone. And I thought, okay, not alone. Father, you are with me. And I looked around and I saw a couple coming out. And I said, okay, I'll just follow them. And they went in the same direction I did. And when I got in there, I said, thank you, Lord. You have provided the way. You provided protection for me. And I'm safely in my car and locked my doors and went home. So the little things are this important. A lot of times people don't, you know, little things happen to us all during the day. And it's so important to be thankful for those things.
All right, that's good. Amen. Anybody else? Two more. Raise your hand right quick. Two more. What was quickened tonight? We read a whole lot of passages.
Well, I think one of the sacrifices of praise, all of them was. And the sacrifice to me is so important because it was a sacrifice for me to come out tonight because I'm exhausted. And I've been yawning off while I'm here asleep. But it was a sacrifice, but that's what we have to do. A sacrifice. And that was one of the practical things that I wanted you to talk about. You know, we know all you're speaking of is what God has done for us legally. But vitally, we have to walk in those things in the natural, but in terms of we have to make the legal vital, and the vital it becomes a reality when we begin to walk into those and lose our rest
tonight.
Well,
the joy
of
the Lord is
standing. Yes. Absolutely. I'm still sleeping under this.
Okay, pick the picture.